Welcome, everybody. I hope you had were able to get ice cream. I did, so that was good. So today I'll be talking about React Native, and I'll be sharing my experience with React Native and the projects we have done with React Native. But first, I will talk a little bit about what React Native is. Then I'll dive into what setup and architecture we used in creating three React Native apps. And at the end of my presentation, I hope you will get a good sense if React Native might be a good fit for your future projects. So I work at Q42. Q42 is an internet agency. We're based in the Netherlands. Our company is like 80 people in total. And we create websites and apps for various clients. We created the whole backend for the Philips Hue light bulbs, for example. But we also created the website for the Rijksmuseum and other stuff. And we also create a lot of mobile apps. Me personally, I'm a mobile developer. I've done a lot of Android projects. And for the past year, I've been working on a React Native project. And I'll be sharing my experiences on that with you today. Since I guess you are all technical people, I kind of assume that you know what this stands for, but I'm going to explain it anyway. It stands for do not repeat yourself. So if you're creating some application and you're writing code, and you're basically writing the same code twice, then that's mostly a sign that there's something wrong. You're writing the same code twice, and it's better if you make it into one function. So why is that a problem? Well, when you're developing apps for both platforms, you're still writing basically the same code twice. So you're writing your code for Android, and you're writing your code for iOS. And why is this a problem? Well, first and foremost, it's just not that fun to do. Most of the time, one of the platforms is ahead of the other. So for example, a team is building the iOS app first, and then the Android app is built secondly. So you're basically typing over somebody else's code. So it's just not that fun to do. At least I think it's not that fun. It's expensive because, well, you're doing the same thing twice. So it takes twice the amount of time, approximately. And it's error prone. Errors are likely to creep into your project, and some inconsistencies will get into your application as time goes by. So your native apps are going to be out of sync at some point in time. And for me, the most important reason is basically this is what your client looks like when you're presenting your work at a sprint demo. Because, yeah, like I said, you're most of the time one platform is ahead, and then when you've been working for weeks on a feature and you're presenting it, then your client is like this because they've all seen it before. It actually happened that a client said at a demo, yes, but you presented this feature last sprint, right? The only thing I see is that there are three weird buttons on the bottom of the screen. Can we remove that? Well, that's because that's Android. So, well, that's kind of my point. So React Native to the rescue. What is React Native? React Native allows you to build applications for Android and iOS using one technology, namely React. To give you a quick example, this is what a React Native app might look like. So we have a class here, a component, which is your app, which has a render function, which returns something that looks like HTML, but it's not. And we have some styles here. These styles look like CSS, but they're not really CSS. It's something that looks like it. And with this code, you basically have your first React Native app. One thing to point out here is that you're writing code in JavaScript. and your JavaScript is running in a JavaScript runtime on the device. But the views that are shown are actually native views. So it's not like some wrapper around a web view which renders HTML. It's actually native, the views are actually native. So that's a big difference, for example, with Cordova or PhoneGap or whatever, where the performance might not be as good. But React Native is not perfect. Like nothing is in the world most of the times. For starters, it's still a young technology. React Native has been around for quite a while now, but we're at version 0.55, and yeah, it's still young. So you're gonna run into stuff you try to figure out in the documentation, maybe some bugs and stuff like that. So it's not not all the problems are out of the way yet. What's the future going to look like for React Native? Basically, the same goes for Flutter. I've seen a couple of Flutter apps talks as well. Also, very promising technology, I think. But when you're developing a native app, then you're pretty sure that you will be able to support this app for a very long time. Nobody knows what the future is going to look like, and nobody knows how life would look like if you have to support a React Native app in 2 or 3 or 4 years' time. So that's something you need to consider when choosing React Native. I think React Native is pretty performant, but it might be not as performant as doing things natively. You might see this in animations, for example, or if you have really complex list views with dynamically items that have a dynamic height, you might run into some performance issues. For example, on Android we have the recycler view, on iOS we have the table view controller. These are components that have been battle tested for years and have all the features you want. But in React Native, the lists are just a little less performant if you get into some weird stuff. And the native feel. If you develop a React Native application, there might be some really subtle differences that might tell you that this is not a native app. It's really subtle, especially with the default form of navigation. I will be getting into that in a couple of minutes. Like I said with animations, here we have a Rijksmuseum app we built, which is filled with all kinds of transitions. If this is a really important thing for you, then React Native might not be the best fit for your project, because it's not impossible to do, but it's harder to do than with native development. So, which apps did we build at Q42? We built three apps. If you're from the Netherlands, then these names will mean something to you. If you're not, then they probably won't mean something to you. But the 538 app is for a radio station. We built an app for the Volkskrant, which is one of the largest newspapers in the Netherlands. And the project I worked on is for Stockholm, which is an app for a startup. And that's a project I worked on, so most of the things I'm going to talk about are in context of the Stockholm app. To give you a little bit of context, Stockholm is an app which is basically a subscription service for groceries. So Stockholm learns how much peanut butter you eat and how much Coca-Cola you drink, and they will make sure that you get a new stuff at home delivered when you're almost out of peanut butter or Coca-Cola or whatever you use. One thing we did when doing this project, we focused on iOS first. So that's I will get back to that in a couple of minutes. All right. So one of the first things we ran into was navigation. With React Native, React Native offers three ways of navigation out of the box. One is platform specific to iOS. One is deprecated, and the other one is pretty limited. So that kind of sucks. And then we have NPM. There are literally more than 100 NPM packages out there which offer some kind of solution for navigation in React Native. And what we did is we didn't use any of them. So what did we do? We went for native navigation. What does this mean? Instead of React Native being like the single activity in your app, we launch activities, each activity containing a native action bar or toolbar in iOS. And then the content view is where we each and every time load a React Native root view into it. Why did we do this? Because you get the native feel for iOS. I will give an example in a couple of seconds. And imagine you have a flow of screens. Then now we have the luxury to decide per screen if we want to implement that screen in React Native, or we might want to do it natively for, I don't know, some reason, fancy animations, I don't know, stuff we want to do that's not possible in React Native. But we have the luxury of swapping out any screen in the app for a native counterpart if we needed to. So to give you an example of the native feel, you can see here that we're navigating through some screens in the app. And on iOS, you can swipe back to navigate back to the previous screen. This is something that doesn't work if you use React Native navigation, the default navigation that's shipped with React Native. And we want these little details. We want the app to feel native. So we went for native navigation, and then you get this stuff for free. And you know for sure that your app will work on phones with notches and stuff like that, because, well, we're basically just using native view controllers for that, or and activities. And it was actually pretty simple to do this. So imagine that we have a screen here with some React Native content and a button. So if you press that button, then in React Native we have an onPress handler here, which basically sends an event to the native code over the React Native bridge, which is very easy to do. And then in the native code, and this is the Kotlin example, but there's also a Swift file that is catching this event, we say, okay, we receive the next event, and then we want to start the next activity. And that activity, again, loads in a React Native view, which shows the content of that screen. And this is the way we went for a navigation, which is really working for us. One of the things we ran into pretty quickly in like 2 weeks, we started out with Flow, which is like the default type system that comes with React Native, or React, I must say. But we weren't really happy with it, so we switched over to TypeScript. The main reason we did this is TypeScript just has better support for third-party libraries, and it has better integration with Visual Studio Code. It gives you better completion and stuff like that. And we were just happier with it. So that's something you might want to consider when you're starting a React Native project. We also ran into a couple of performance issues. I will show you a video here where we're launching, we're navigating through the app, and we're launching a screen which allows users to like Tinder through some groceries and say, I want this on my grocery list and I don't want this. And the video, it runs smoothly, but the jerkiness you're going to see is really how the app felt. So we're launching the screen and we start swiping. And then all of a sudden, the app was really starting to hiccup and really performing very, very badly. So that's something we saw, and we thought, okay, what's going on here? So we started investigating, and what was actually happening was caused by a couple of choices we made coming together. So it was not React Native's fault, by definition, because what was happening is if you navigate to that feature, you're basically building up a stack of screens on top of each other. Because we are using native navigation, you have now three activities living on top of each other. And since we were using Firebase, which basically updates all the screens in real time, this was happening. If we were swiping cards to the left and the right on that activity, then the screen, which is not visible at all, was updated. So it was triggering renders while the screen wasn't visible at all. And if you have had a stack of five screens, then it was updating five screens which were not visible. So that was causing the performance issues. And we were able to easily fix this by propagating the methods from the native side to React Native. And I don't know if there are any React developers in the audience, but what we did is, when the view is not visible to the user, then there's a method in React, should component update, which basically tells React to not render, re-render itself. So when the screen is not visible, we simply return false. And then the performance issues were gone. As you can see here, we can now swipe through the groceries and everything is running smoothly. So even the reason I'm also showing this is, even though I just said that React Native might not be as performant as native, you can still build pretty awesome stuff with it. And I just said we were using Firebase in the past tense, and that's because we're not using Firebase anymore. I could give a whole separate talk about that, but we switched over from Firebase to a REST API. If you want to know why, then come and find me after the talk, and we can talk about that some more. One thing we noticed when creating the Android app was that the image component that React Native ships with is kind of sucks. So we stopped using that and we started using a great NPM package out there called FastImage, because the default image component that React Native ships with had all kinds of memory leaks and it was performing really, really worse, bad. And FastImage basically just wraps Glide, which is a library that Android developers know and love for showing images. So another thing we ran into when looking at the app on Android, because we first started out on creating the iOS app and then later on started looking at the Android implementation, was that the designer designed this screen, but on Android it looked like this. So we noticed that the edge shadows weren't working on Android. Now it turns out that you can use shadows on Android. We were defining them in the CSS, like a box shadow, but that doesn't work on Android. You can use shadows on Android with the elevation property, but yeah, we made a different choice. We just decided to eradicate all the shadows out of the designs, and the designer came up with the design that works without shadows. So that was a choice we made. One of the things that kind of makes you want to cry sometimes is upgrading React Native. This has to do with the setup we chose. We chose a native first setup. So by default, you can create a new React Native project by command line, and then it generates all this stuff for you. It generates all kinds of Objective-C code for iOS, and it generates stuff for Android as well. But we wanted to have a native first setup. So we wanted to use Swift. We wanted to use CocoaPods on iOS. We wanted to use Kotlin on Android. So what we did is we set up the projects in the native tool sets, and then we integrated React Native into those projects. This is something that React Native supports by default, but I don't think they use it very often, because every time you want to upgrade, then especially on iOS, you have to do all kinds of dirty tricks to get things working again. Luckily, you can find stuff on GitHub issues, for example, but we are still doing this stuff, basically just replacing source code with set scripts to get things working on iOS. which, like I just said, kind of makes you want to cry. But it's not all bad. I'm not here to tell you what's all bad about React Native. React Native has lots of benefits as well. And I think one of the best features about React Native is that, like I said, we have done three projects, and each and every project had a different architecture, a different approach of using React Native. So the first project we did was for the radio station, and that's basically a full-on React Native project, which was created by the command line, and the team consisted of almost only React developers. So it was really heavy on the React Native side. As you can see, the arrow is not all the way to the left. That's because you almost always need some kind of native code, for example, for showing notifications, because React Native doesn't give you all the possible APIs that are available on Android or iOS. It gives you like the basics and the things that you need most. But if you want to do something special, then it's very easy to write your own module and in native and implement that that like you would normally do on Android or iOS. I think that's a cool feature of React Native. So there's no waiting for features and new features of Android to be available in React Native, because it's very easy to just write your own module and do it yourself. And then for the newspaper app, there was a whole different approach. So there, the most of the code base is native code, like all the business logic, fetching data from an API, it's all native. But there are a few very complex components for rendering articles, which we really wanted to share on both platforms, because it's a newspaper. It's really important that the fonts and stuff, it's all the same on both platforms. So the business logic is all native, but the rendering of the articles is done with React Native, because we really wanted to share that code. And for the Stockholm app, the project that I worked on, we're kind of in the middle. We use native navigation, so we don't use React Native navigation, but most of the code is in React Native. We're actually, I think 90% or even more of the code is TypeScript. And like I said, I think this is the best feature of React Native, because it's very easy to gradually add React Native into an existing project or mix and match native and React Native in your project. And one really cool thing is that we're not only sharing code on Android and iOS, but we're also sharing code with our backend, because we have a Node.js backend. We're sharing things like validation, models, some small utility functions. We can also reuse that on the backend. So that's really nice. It really saves you a lot of time. What we also found is that in React Native, you can lay out your responsive screens using Flexbox, which is familiar for web developers. And we found that this actually quite works very well when laying out screens that work on both Android and iOS. We had no problems whatsoever creating different complex layouts with Flexbox. And one thing that made that especially easy is that React Native supports hot code reloading. This is gives you a really nice developer experience. If you're playing around and you're creating a screen, you're adding some components, you hit save and bam, you can see your updates on the simulator or on your device. And this not only works for adding UI components, but if you change something in your business logic, in your JavaScript code, it just reloads, and that's really speeding up development cycle. Another thing that we found is that we actually really like React, because it's a really nice component framework. And in native, for both Android and iOS, this is actually not so easy to get it right. And React is a component framework from the ground up, which really gives you nice standards on how to create components, share, break your application up into smaller parts. You can easily use stuff like Redux or something. If it works with React, then it also works with React Native. And there are loads of NPM packages out there that can help you with different stuff you're trying to solve. But here comes the big one, of course. We have been working for 4 months on the iOS app and creating all the different screens and navigation there. And we literally had the Android app running in a matter of days. Because we are using native navigation, we have to do some work on the native side, wrapping the root components in an activity and starting activities when we receive events. But we had this up and running in a matter of days. So can you imagine from 4 months work to 1 week? That's pretty impressive. So what things should you consider when doing a React Native project? One of the things we learned, like I said, the radio station app is the first app we used React Native for. And we were a little bit naive, but the team consisted of mostly React developers. You start writing the application, and in the beginning it's all nice and easy. But then, like I said, at some point you will need to write some native code for showing notifications or maybe doing some other stuff. And we found that if you do not have native experience in your team, then that can take up a lot of time. Because if a React developer has to figure out how he needs to show notifications on Android and iOS, then you might be losing some weeks. So my tip is that if you're doing a React Native project, then make sure you have some React Native experience on the team, but also native experience. We started out with iOS, but if you're doing a React Native project and you want to focus on one platform first, I would recommend doing Android first, because the most of the issues we ran into were on Android. So if your app works on Android, then it's very likely that it will also work on iOS, but the other way around is not always the case. And last but not least, make sure that everybody is on board for your decision to use React Native. It's not only a thing that you as a technical choice you're making, but it has impact on the app. So make sure that your customer is aware of this, and the designers in your team are aware of this, and that developers are aware of this. For us, this was the case. It was a really conscious decision supported by the client. We said, we think React Native is a good match for this project. It's a startup and they want to iterate fast. But sometimes if a designer comes with a design or a feature or whatever, and it's just not possible with React Native or it's very hard, then you have to be pragmatic. So for example, with the shadows, of course, we could have got the shadows working on Android, but maybe that would have taken us a week to figure out. And we made a pragmatic choice, and we were able to just continue without a hassle. So it's really important that everybody is on board, from your client, your designer, and your developers. So, React Native, buy one, get one free. Well, I would say no, because you're not actually cutting your development time in half. It's not that you don't have to do any work on the other platform. We found that especially ramping up the project, some stuff was new for us. We had to find out flow that doesn't work. We switched to TypeScript. We needed to set up the project, and we were a bit slower there than usual, than setting up a native project. But in the end, and even now, where we're a year in with the project, we're still noticing that the development time is so much faster. If we're seeing what time kind of features we're rolling out and at what speed we're iterating, if we would have needed to do that in two native platforms, it would have taken us loads and loads of more time. So I think that if React Native is a good fit for your project, so you can be pragmatic and you can make sometimes make decisions and live with some of the limitations of React Native, then I definitely think that React Native will save you a lot of time and still give you a very nice developer experience. I was coming from Kotlin, which is a very nice language, and then it feels like a real step back to going back to do JavaScript. But still, I must say that with TypeScript and all the promise niceness that you have, it's still a pretty nice development environment. And with the hot code reloading, you can really iterate fast when developing an app. So that was my experience with creating React Native apps. And I was wondering if you have any questions about this.
Thank you so much.
Any questions? There's a question in the front there.
I was wondering, when you're dealing with a certain kind of native component like a map that takes a lot of interaction and is very, very deeply rooted in the native part, how is this affecting development? Because you have to maybe deal a lot of events coming from the map and then bringing it back from React Native. How is this working well?
I would say that if you want to implement a map component, I would just create a native component for that. So it's very easy, if you have a screen in React Native, then it's very easy to create a native component, which is embedded inside native components. I would just go for a native component there, I guess. Because, well, on both Android and iOS, you have perfectly working map components you can use. So. Any more questions?
Hello, can you explain your test setup?
Yeah, so we have unit tests for the business logic. We're using just your regular JavaScript test tools for that, Jest. We don't have any front-end testing. We have a tester on the project which does manual testing of the features itself. So we don't test the screens, but we do have unit tests for the business logic. Yeah.
If you could go back a year with the knowledge you have now, would you make the same decision to go with it?
Definitely. Like I said, it's no silver bullet, but nothing is, I guess. And if I look at how fast it is to iterate and develop stuff and how much time React Native saves us, sometimes it leaves you pulling your hair out when you need to upgrade, but most of the time it's very good. Maybe if we're developing a next application, we might consider using Flutter, because that also sounds promising. I've been watching a couple of talks on that. But we started almost 2 years back, and then Flutter wasn't really an option, and React Native was like the best cross-platform option at the time.
Okay. Yeah.